special event. This is very special for us at this side because we've been preparing for this for many months. This is an event in which we are going to be discussing global economic governance issues. We're going to be discussing how we govern trade, how we govern investment, what is it that we need to do to build more resilience in our financial system, how do we manage migration, how do we address the challenges posed by climate change, how do we build a new compact between workers and employers. All of this is what we're going to be talking about. Now, the extra, and by now I'm sure that you all are dying to dive into the book, but the little extra is that all these issues in this book are being addressed by women. This is not a book about women. It's a book by women. We talk a lot about women's issues. But what we wanted to do is have women talk about the issues that make the front pages of newspapers around the world. And what is it? Why is it that we wanted to do this? Because we were getting a bit tired of the society pretending that this expertise does not exist. Well, it does exist. It is there. It's amazing. It's diverse. And this is another thing you will see in the book. Those women that have written the book, they hold high offices like Chancellor Merkel or the Prime Minister of Barbados, Mia Martin. They are in the front pages of the newspapers like Christine Lagarde, like Cecilia Malmstro. But there are many others that are doing amazing work that we want to value, that we want to render more visible. This is what this event is about. So in order to convince you read the book, you don't even have to buy it. You can download it, because this has to be a global public good. What we thought we would do is give the voice to many of these women. Now, these 28 women in the book are just a very small subset of the many other women around this world. So we wanted to start a movement. We don't want to end here with this book. We want to start a movement where we encourage more and more women that are thinking about global economic governance issues to become more visible to the world. And for that, we will be opening a space on our website where any woman who wants to do that can post their publications. Again, we don't want to end with the 28, we want to start with the 28, and this is why we want to start with two women that are not in the book, but that have a lot to say about global economic governance issues. So let me briefly start today's session by giving the floor to Minister Ann Linde. She's the Minister Trade Sweden. She certainly has a lot to say about global economic governance issues, starting with international trade and investment. So, Anne, floor is yours.
Thank you, Arancha, and thank you to you and to the ITC for inviting me here. I'm just going to read that book on the plane home, really dying to see what all those amazing women are writing. It is a great honor for me to be here and introducing this book because it reflects actually not only ITC but also the Swedish values where women contribute to discussions and how to encourage women participation in economic affairs and participation in international trade. But I have been asked to begin with a few words on the Swedish feminist government, so I'll start there. In the case of Sweden, women's economic empowerment and participation in the labor force made possibly already in the 70s, mainly through three important reforms in the 70s. First, it was the abolition of the joint taxation system. Second, it was the expansion of the publicly funded affordable child and elderly care. And thirdly, it was the reform of the parental insurance that allows mothers and fathers to take parental leave on equal terms. This was a good start, but it was not enough, as inequalities still exist in our society, so more has to be done. So when we came into power in 2014, the first thing we did was to state that our government is a feminist government, and we made a clear commitment to promoting gender equality in all policy making. During the past years, we have combated inhibitive gender roles and structure, and we have let gender equality have a formative impact on policy choices, priorities, in allocation of resources. The government pursues this agenda in all facets of its work, in Sweden, in EU, and globally. Gender equality permeates all areas of Sweden's foreign policy, security, promotion, public democracy, and of course, development cooperation and trade. As trade minister, I wish to see that trade contributes to growth and jobs for everyone, women and men. We have therefore worked hard for a gender equality in the WTO, the EU Free Trade Agreement, and in other relevant foreign platforms. The crown of the work was 2017, where I and Arancha was part of the launching of the Buenos Aires Declaration. And to be here today and talking about trade and gender tells me that some of that work has been successful. But we still have a long way to go to have an equal society that gains from international trade and affects women and men equally. The National Board of Trade in Sweden will publish a report on trade and gender gaps just after the summer break, but I have read it already. This agency's research will support us in taking further steps in our work for a feminist trade policy. Already now, I would like to repeat my earlier call upon all organizations in the trade community that haven't already done so to systematically collect gender disaggregated data and include gender in all analyses. We won't be able to formulate gender-equal measures of trade rules if we don't have an accurate picture of the situation in different policy areas. ITC is one of the important organizations that is contributing with analysis and data. I am proud that Sweden provides flexible, un-earmarked funding so that the ECT can use funding for projects supporting green economy, women entrepreneurs, she trades, young startups, skills training, and vulnerable population influencing refugees. All this for the common Swedish and ITC goal to use trade as a tool for sustainable development and equality between men and women. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And let me now turn to another very important figure in this morning's event. She is the Vice President of the Gambia. She's got a long history in the health sector. She's got a short but intense history in the trade sector. But she's now the Vice President of the country. I want to introduce you to Issatou Touré, Vice President of the Gambia.
With great pleasure to be here this morning to join you in this very important launch of the publication, Women Shaping Global Economic Governance, put together by extraordinary women that are contributing and promoting good governance, diversity, and driving economic and sustainable growth and development. I would like to join Her Excellency Lynn and everyone in this room to celebrate the contributors and female leaders adding their voices to the various aspects of the global economy, from finance to trade and investment, and across very important priority sectors. I would like to particularly acknowledge the work of International Trade Center, ITC, for their contribution to sustainable growth and development in developing countries, including the Gambia, where the ITC's footprint continues to grow and capturing the momentum. With women owning approximately 10 million of the world's MSMEs, sustainable economic growth and the achievement of development goals can only be achieved through the active participation of women. In the Gambia, for example, about 63% of MSMEs are microenterprises, and 90% of the microenterprises are informal, with 80% comprising of women involved in distributive trade, gardening and other handicrafts, and artisanal trade. Women, therefore, actively participate in several key sectors of the economy, including agriculture, fisheries, forestry, agro-processing, and domestic and cross-border trade. I can extrapolate this for many African women across the continent. Personally, I have been consistently involved at all levels in promoting women empowerment, gender equity and equality to sustain economic growth and sustainable development. Therefore, this book is a call to action for bridging the gender gap through inclusive trade, and I thank the ITC for pioneering this important publication, indeed a feminist project. Emphasizing women as agents of change and growth is not a new concept. That women have led movements for change at every level and been an integral part of society, political, economic, and social. But it is good to remind us all just how much women still have to say about where our world is going. It's very key. I congratulate all the contributors to this book, and I believe it is the beginning of more engagement from women from diverse experiences involved in trade and economics. And it's all about the feminist politics that we're trying to advance in bringing the voices of those who are behind leading. Thank you very much.
Talking about diversity, in this book there is much more. There is the Central Bank of the Russian Federation, Elvira Nabiulina. There is Linda Moholo, former Central Bank Botswana. There is Ngozi Okonjo-Iweala, chair of the Gavi. It's all over the world. Now, it's also at the ITC. This book is the product of a lot of hard work by Marion Jansen, who's our chief economist. She's gonna be doing the most difficult part, which is the wrapping up after I've done all this blah, blah. So that's when you will hear from her. And this book is also the product of a collaboration with the Center for European Policy Reform, CEPR, and the European Institute, University Institute Florence. Again, partnerships to drive this discussion forward. Let me now move to the panel. Let me start by briefly introducing you to Leila Baghdadi. She's professor at the Tunis Business School. Gabrielle Marceau, in this house, she needs no introduction, but she's one of the brightest legal minds on trade that I know. Nuria Oliver, another very bright mind. She is a world authority on artificial intelligence, member of the Spanish Royal Academy of Engineering. Anabel Gonzalez, another person that in this house needs little presentation. Former trade minister of Costa Rica, now senior fellow at the Peterson Institute. And last but not least, we wanted to surprise you a little bit, Maria Teresa Quintero. She didn't write for the book, but she's going to be doing that. She is the young generation. She's co-founded with other Mexican colleagues at Trade Tank, a think tank exclusively devoted to discussing trade matters. And she's going to be offering for the next edition a good chapter. Let me now start with Anabel. Anabel, in your contribution to the book, you speak about four possible futures on trade and investment, four possible scenarios on trade and investment. What do you think will be the most likely scenario, and why do you think this will be?
Well, Well, first of all, thank you very much, Arancha, and my recognition to you and to Marion for this initiative, and I'm very humbled to be here among this wonderful setting and with this wonderful women, so thank you very much. With trade confrontations, new technologies, and geopolitical competition reshaping the global economy, the trade and investment policy landscape is changing very rapidly, and it's in a state of flux. And there are several plausible scenarios for the future of trade and investment depending on the interplay of a number of factors. From the geopolitical perspective, I think that the key question is, will countries opt to cooperate internationally, or will they select a unilateral path? And from the economic perspective, I think that the critical question is, will countries choose to move towards lower or greater ease of cross-border movement of goods, services, capital, and people? So the four scenarios, which we developed with another colleague, Yelling Pan, and the World Economic Forum, are the following. First, what we call open international rules, which is where countries cooperate to address issues through a revitalized WTO and complementary international frameworks. A second scenario, which we call competing coalitions, basically is where countries collaborate but are often drawn into competing spheres with blocs outside of the WTO. A third scenario we call technological disruption, where countries cannot cooperate and technology races ahead of regulation, creating a borderless world for some, but also great uncertainty and insecurity. And last but not least, our fourth scenario we've called sovereignty first, where in the absence of cooperation, prohibited unilateral barriers lead to inefficiencies, high economic risks, and a decline in productivity and innovation. So you ask me, where are we today? Well, quite frankly, I have to say that when I get asked this question, I need to watch the news 15 minutes before I come to the event. And I was not able to do that today. That the landing zone of this current spat is still at play. But I think three features are emerging. First, the revival of managed trade, a policy focused on achieving concrete outcomes through government intervention, mostly tariffs, but also export controls and investment controls. Second, greater fragmentation of trade rules with a flurry of activity leading to new or revised arrangements with potential competing spheres of influence. And third, the weakening of trade global governance, with three major tensions underlying the multilateral trading system. One, whether there are new rules that are needed to address the differences between market economies and trade capitalism. Second, whether we need new digital rules, new rules for the digital economy. And third, what can be the contribution of emerging economies to the system? So let me stop here, Arancha. Thank you.
Thank you, Anabel. And it's a nice segue to Nuria. You mentioned technologies and technology as one of these big disrupting forces that are entering also very strongly into trade and investment. With machine learning, with big data, with artificial intelligence, how do we leverage all these forces for good? To help us achieve
the sustainable development goals. Thank you, Arancha. Well, first of all, thank you very much for inviting me to contribute to such an interesting book. I was fascinated by the idea when Arancha contacted me, and I was a little bit surprised because I am a computer scientist, and I thought, well, what can I write about trade, you know? But I think it was a smart move and a reflection of the increasingly important role that technology plays in all the spheres of our lives, you know, including trade, you know, and the economy. So my chapter, which is towards the end of the book, I think it's page 171, talks about the challenges in governance when we live in a world of data-driven decision-making algorithms. Increasingly, algorithms are making decisions that have impacts in the lives of millions of people. Decisions about which medical treatment you receive. Decisions about which judicial sentence you are applied to. Decisions in terms of, this happens already for many years, whether you're giving credit or not. decisions on whether they're giving you a job or not, and which salary you're being given, and so forth. So in that context, we need to, as a society, understand that this is happening and demand, I think, certain features, I guess, or guarantees that these algorithms will need to satisfy to actually make sure that they have positive social impact. And you might ask, and why would we want to use algorithms? I mean, we've been making decisions, you know, these decisions all our lives, you know, as human beings. But we all know from history and from recent history that human decision making is not perfect. We are subject to corruption, to conflicts of interest, to cognitive biases, to greediness. So the idea and the aspiration is to say, well, if we have a lot of data that is a reflection of the underlying reality that we live in, and we are able to make sense of this data using sophisticated algorithms, maybe those algorithms will help us make evidence-driven decisions, decisions that are immune to our own limitations. So that's the goal. And I work for that goal, and that's one of the motivations of my work on artificial intelligence. But we need to be aware of the limitations of existing systems before we achieve this goal. So in my chapter, I summarize a lot of the limitations and the dimensions that I think are important into an acronym that I call PHATON in English. And I'll very quickly say what each letter means. So F for PHATON means fairness. We want algorithms to be more fair, but we are finding that algorithms also discriminate. Maybe because the data that we use to train them is biased. Maybe because we're using the wrong model. Maybe because we're making the wrong interpretation of the model. So fairness is something that we should demand, and guarantees on fairness is something that we should expect. The A is triple, is for autonomy, augmentation, and accountability. Why autonomy? Autonomy is a key value in Western ethics, and the principle of autonomy says that we humans should be free to decide our own actions and our own thoughts. However, all of us today and every day constantly interact with algorithms that in many cases know us better than we know ourselves, and that exploit our own weaknesses to guide our decision making around behaviors. So I would claim that our own autonomy is being tested and questioned every day in a subliminal way and in a non-transparent way. So we as a society should demand that our autonomy is preserved. Accountability, I think, is clear, is that we need to really understand who is responsible for the consequences of the use of these algorithms when we're using complex systems that are analyzing data from different places and using software developed by different people. And finally, the third meaning of A is intelligence augmentation. I think the most positive impact will be achieved when the model is that we complement human intelligence by algorithmic or computational means. Computers are very good, much better than us, for example, in complex large-scale data processing tasks. So maybe they can do that, but we are much better than algorithms in many other tasks. So I think the idea would be how can we complement ourselves rather than replace ourselves. The T is double, is for trust and transparency. I think we are increasingly losing trust in the technology that we use, and I see headlines almost every day now, and I think with a reason, because all these other conditions are not being met, you know, the fairness, you know, the transparency and so forth. So the T is also for transparency. We need to demand transparency, and I think the European GDPR regulation is a step forward, but we need to have transparency also in terms of when we are interacting with an algorithm versus a human, exactly, you know, what is this algorithm doing, why is the algorithm deciding whatever is deciding, and so forth. The E for PHATON is triple, is E for education. I don't think we are taking seriously enough the education challenge at all levels. I think most children are receiving a second industrial revolution education, and we live in the fourth industrial revolution. I don't think we are taking seriously the challenges and the tensions in the labor market that are happening and that will be happening when we coexist with intelligent, you know, algorithms and systems. The investments that we need to make in educating people whose skills are going to be obsolete or whose capacities need to be transformed is massive. And finally, we need to invest in education to policymakers and decision makers, because many times they are making decisions about topics that they don't fully understand, and therefore have difficulties in figuring out what is the right decision. The E is also for beneficence, and here I'm cheating because beneficence starts with a B, but it has an E. And beneficence means maximizing the positive impact. We need to always, as I always say, not every innovation is progress. The target should be progress, not necessarily innovation. There are many things that we can do for the sake of being able to do them that don't represent progress, you know, for society. So we need to take into account sustainability, for example, diversity, you know, in the technology field. There is only 10% of women who choose computer science in many countries today, when it was almost 40% in the 80s. What is happening? We live in a world of technology that has been designed by homogeneous, non-diverse teams. This is extremely dangerous for society. And the E is also for equality. There is a polarization in the accumulation of wealth, and some authors attribute that polarization to the fourth industrial revolution and a technological development. And finally, the N for phaeton is for non-maleficence. So non-maleficence is not exactly the opposite to beneficence. Non-maleficence means minimizing the negative impact, ensuring that there is guarantees of safety, security, reliability, and also that, you know, human privacy is always preserved. So I wrap up the chapter by saying that I do believe that we can do better thanks to the existence of data and algorithms. I do believe that we won't be able to tackle the pressing challenges that we face today, including sustainability, climate change, the aging of the population, the prevalence of chronic disease, etc., without the help of technology and particularly artificial intelligence. But that path is not a guaranteed path. We need to make sure that the technology that we develop satisfies this fate and criteria, so we really achieve this idea of developing technology for the people and by the people. Thank you.
Thank you. Wow, that was an eye-opener. That was an eye-opener, and I liked a lot that you mentioned work. You mentioned skill, but you mentioned work. And I want to now move to Gabrielle, because considerations on work, on environment, on human rights are becoming much more central to economic policymaking, and yet the WTO, the multilateral global trading system, has had a very complicated relationship with some of these dimensions that are now mainstream dimensions. They are no longer the afterthought after you do trade or after you do investment. Now, how, Gabrielle, how can we modernize a little bit trade policy to incorporate these new dimensions in a manner that is felt, as Nuria said, in a manner that is felt as fair, and not just as giving some people an unfair trade or investment advantage?
Thank you very much, Arancha, for including me, and thank you to all your teams for the organization of this event and the book. It was really impeccable. And as you mentioned, my topic is trade and labor. I did work in labor before going into trade, and I remained sensitive on the importance, as you said just before me, trade remains to be and is done by people for people, and labor, like human rights, reminds us that all this is done by human being. But I took trade and labor because historically, labor consideration, labor standard were part of the package in the Havana Charter, and we all know that the Havana died, US withdrew, and we stayed with the GATT that dealt with tariff and a few things. But the so-called non-trade concern, and Arancha mentioned, social consideration, health, environment, this relationship between trade and health and human rights is a relationship that has evolved importantly and in very, very positive stride under the WTO, in good part thanks to the case law and the dispute and the jurisprudence. This is really an area where I would give AAA to the system. And this was done based on three elements that are relevant also for the trade and woman debate. First, the WTO mentioned in its preamble that one of its goals is sustainable development. And with this, in case of dispute, the appellate body said early on, governments have many obligations other than trade, and they have rights to give priority to non-trade concern if they do it properly. So slowly,
the case law has recognized that trade and environment and trade and health are at equal footing for governments and must be operation in accordingly. Now, labor is not mentioned as often as health or environment in the WTO, but it can also be read in some of the exceptions, such as the protection of public moral or public order. But another step that was made by the case law is when the appellate body recognized and made clear that governments can make distinctions between products so long as these regulatory distinctions are based on legitimate objectives. And one of the legitimate objective is sustainable development. So a lot of things can be brought under this, and this flexibility is fundamental to bring in labor. The third and my last comment will be when the case law recognizes in an important dispute between EU, India, and Pakistan that the donor of preferences can condition those preferences on non-trade concern, so long as these non-trade concerns are really objective, really aimed at development, and so long as similarly situated countries are treated similarly. So thanks to the WTO system, I think, and its flexibility, the link between labor and trade, but also all non-trade concerns, are back together. Maybe not as well as you would wish, Arancha, as many of us think it should be done, as it was initially thought in the Havana Charter, but very, very importantly advanced from what the situation was 20 years ago. And this trade and, or the so-called non-trade concern, is one of the door to bring in more consideration for women. And some governments have, as you mentioned, already started introducing these elements in regional trade agreement, and this will only continue to expand. So thank you again for involving me.
Thank you, Gabrielle. Thank you very much. And for those of you who do not know, this house was built to house the International Labour Organization. This was the House of Work. So if you look up, you will see the allegories of work in one of the most beautiful pieces of the original building that is this center, William Rapar. So there was historically a link between trade and work. Let me now move to another dimension of people, which is migrants are, again, is one of these themes that is making the headlines of newspapers and media all around the world. Leila, you have told us in your contribution that we should look at migrants as people who are there and here. Tell us what this means.
Thank you first, Arancha, and I would like to thank the ITC for doing this book. It's very important. I was extremely excited when first Marion spoke about this book in Tunis last year. And I'm also very happy to speak about migration, because migration is really a part of globalization. We always think in terms of trade, investment, but migration is fully a symptom, a factor. They have also an important role in driving globalization. Then I was very happy to contribute on this. And in general, also when you look to debates about migration, it's kind of negative, generally. Or at least in my country, when you speak about migration, we are speaking about remittances, transfers. Well, it's very important. In Africa, remittances is actually higher than aid for trade. Sometimes it could be even higher than investment. Then it's extremely important. But we forget that migrants are also agents of trade, agents of investment, and they contribute a lot in this respect. If you look to trade, why migrants actually are playing a huge role in this? They alleviate, they reduce information asymmetries. They put in touch, in general, exporters or traders in host countries with home countries. They also play a huge role in promoting ethnic goods, which is not at all anecdotal, it's very important. And there is a lot of untapped potential also in terms of services. We still don't know how we could completely seize or benefit from migration in health services, in education services. The importance also here, we should really focus or highlight the importance of certification, of twinnings, of accreditation, and how we can use migrants at home or abroad. For investors, I worked on migration 15 years ago, but I was really surprised by how it evolved. Migrants now, they are not investing in a passive way. They are taking another dimension. They would like to play structural transformation in their country. For instance, I was surprised to find that many migrants will create funds to invest in SMEs back in their countries, to invest in startups, to create accelerators, to create crowdfunding platforms. That's really evolving. They are active. They are really active in that way. They also play a huge role to collect funds and fund public or private goods, like, for instance, mall in Afghanistan or whatever. Then here again, in the origin countries, they are looking at this. Then we hear about diaspora bans, we hear about deposit with remuneration, etc. Now, to the question that for a long time, migrants were asking themselves this question, shall I stay or shall I go? I think they partially answered to that. They are saying, I'm here and there. They emerged as transnational networks, playing, and if they really want to play a role in being between home and host countries. And this is very important because to the new perception of migrants by themselves, to themselves, also host and home countries, they should change policies. Then they should think and rethink about migrant policies in terms of diaspora-led trade and investment. To do this, really the political will is needed, and governance here plays a huge role. Then I also would like to thank you because of this chapter, this sparked a thought and a lot of discussion as I'm a member of the Council of Economic Analysis, and we are trying really to think what we can do. Then thank you again for this work.
Amazing. Thank you so much, Leila. Thank you. So as usual, it doesn't stop here. That's important for all of you. I want you to start thinking about the questions you want to put to the floor, because after Maria Jose gets to her, gives us her views, it's your turn. Maria Jose, Maria Teresa, sorry. Maria Teresa, you've created this think tank in Mexico, Trade Tank, because you think something has to be done about global economic governance in Mexico, and maybe from Mexico, share this experience with the rest of the world. Tell us what you think should be done.
Thank you very much, first of all, for inviting us and for trusting our project. And it's a pleasure for me to share this panel with distinguished panelists, as all of you are. Let me tell you about Trade Tank, MX. It is the only think tank in Mexico specialized in international trade and integrated by young people. Let me emphasize that more than half of these members are women, such as our president, Alcira, which is here in the audience.
Alcira,
yes,
get up.
Please.
I need to see you.
We have three principal objectives of Trade Tank. The first one is to analyze international trade matters in order to make and create specific policies, because these do not exist in Mexico. The second one is to promote informed and smart dialogue. And the third one is to be a facilitator to those sectors that have been less involved in international trade, just as small and medium enterprises and women. In this regard, we consider that trade tank in itself directly contributes to make inclusive growth in Mexico. Because we are developing as a key actor that influences the trade policy making in Mexico. And we have three competitive advantages. The first one is that we have intuitive sense of how changes are happening. The second one is that we could design research agenda in global impact. And the third one is that we could develop policy solutions tailored to a specific circumstances.
Thank you. Thank you, Maria Teresa. I mean, this is the young generation. I mean, unsurprisingly, it's a bit intimidating, especially when you're in this very very traditional library. But I can tell you, I had a session with all of you when I was in Mexico City about a month ago, and they have incredible ideas that they are pushing through. And not only that, but they are also helping other younger students integrate the path, probably students that don't have the means to do that by themselves, integrate the path they've been going through. Now, over to you. Questions, comments, observations, agreements or disagreements? Don't be too shy, please. Go ahead. The International Gender Champions, Women in Trade Workstream.
Right, just before she goes on too long to tell you about things I don't know anything about, I just wanted to say good morning, it's still morning, and congratulations to you, Arancha, ITC, and all the wonderful women authors. It really lightens my heart to see that what I know already, but many people don't know, that there are powerful, intelligent, and dynamic women out there in the world everywhere who sadly, and even many more, that are not being called upon to contribute to the progress of our society. So I just want to say congratulations and thanks a lot. I mean, this book I have not read yet, but I know about it because I saw the subjects. One of the authors is a former governor of our central bank, Ms. Lina Mohotha, a very accomplished woman. And I'm happy to be here, in a way, representing her, and I'll be sending her photos of this event. But Arancha, I just want to say that the breadth of subjects that are covered in this book, I think, and what we've heard from the panelists this morning, shows just how much women thinkers have to contribute to understanding the links between trade and everything, if I may say so, but most importantly, development and progress. And I think that it does lend support to research that has been conducted that shows that women do have a certain special skill and certain intuition that sees many different things at the same time, that is able to juggle. And I think that the world needs contribution not only from men who are very good at these things, but that women have other contributions to make to the intellectual analysis of many of the issues that confront the world. This was really just a comment to encourage all of us to continue to contribute in the way that these women are doing. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Any question on your side? Alcira.
So this is Alcira, and I wanted to say that every time I enter to a panel, and you may, or a session, I count how many suits and how many more colorful dresses or skirts or even pants. Most of the time, men are the ones who are taking the place, and it's very good to have these spaces where the spotlight is in women, and as Arancha said, by women, not because of, because all of you are prepared. And what I wanted to say is that every woman in this room should take the ITC platform and write a paper as in your experience. Thank you very much, Arancha, for having us.
Thank you. Anybody else wants to take the floor? Sure. Ambassador of Barbados to the WTO and the UN.
Thank you very much, Arancha. Firstly, let me commend you and ITC and everyone here for an excellent launch, an excellent book put together, notwithstanding the fact that our Prime Minister has contributed as well. But I also want to say this ought to be a reading across all of the universities of the world. I think it's something that every young woman needs to have a copy of, whether you're into politics or trade or diplomacy or simply trying to understand what's going on in the world. And I think that this is an excellent launchpad for such. And I will be pushing for, particularly in our sphere of the world, in the Caribbean, for the University of the West Indies. I don't know the distribution network that you have, but this ought to be on every student's reading material. And I really want to commend ITC for such a launch. Thank you very
Thank
much.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Let me be a bit cheeky. Nuria, this is the House of Trade Negotiations, and these trade negotiators seem to have a lot of trouble getting to deals. Could artificial intelligence help? Could we imagine using this subconscious, unconscious, beyond
yes.
conscious?
Yes,
could we do that?
Indeed, there is actually work on that, and some of it is by my thesis advisor, Professor Sandy Penland at MIT. So it's exactly related to what you just mentioned about unconscious signals. So there is an interesting book. It's not technical, so you could, or if you are not, you don't have to be a computer scientist to understand it. It's called Honest Signals, and the book shows evidence on the fact that something that has already been found, but maybe not so quantitatively, which is that all of us humans, when we communicate, we sort of like emit and receive and interpret a wide and rich variety of signals at a subconscious level that are actually influencing the decisions we're making and the words that we are saying. So in the literature, for example, of just of communication, you know, there are studies that found that 70 to 80% of human communication is nonverbal. It's not what I say, it's how I say it. But it goes beyond communication. So there are studies, particularly in negotiating salaries, very interesting studies, where using artificial intelligence and a wealth of sensors to be able to capture all this nonverbal behavior, the algorithms were able to predict with fairly high accuracy, first of all, if it was a situation of a candidate for a job interviewing for the job. So within 5 minutes, the algorithm could predict if the person was going to get the job or not. But it was able to predict the salary range that it was going to be offered within like a very small margin of error. So I do think, and again, I think it falls in this idea of augmentation. I do think, and this is actually, I initiated that work in my PhD thesis. One of the topics that I tackled was building artificial intelligence models of human interactions. So understanding human interactions computationally is very complex. And from that work, at MIT, my team and my professor continue the work on understanding these social sort of like signals. So I think that it could be very interesting to augment existing negotiations computationally, mainly to help humans, to help understand, you know, what is failing in a negotiation, what kind of language is being sent, not what you're saying, but how you're saying it. Maybe detecting that if it's deviating in the wrong way, maybe intervening to prevent something really horrible happening, right? So all of these exist at a research level, and I think it would be fascinating to test it in this situation. So anyone who wants to take on the challenge, we could collaborate on that.
So we're looking for a candidate to use artificial intelligence in WTO negotiations. There is a candidate there, apparently.
Well. Not sure I'm the right one for that. Amrita Bahari, WTO chair from Mexico. And I just want to follow up. Before, I want to congratulate you for this wonderful, wonderful initiative. And finally, want to follow up on my friend's point here, Ambassador Blackman's point, that this could be a very useful teaching resource for the upcoming courses on trade and gender. And I really can't be more excited to be here for this launch and to have this book in my hand, because in 2 days, I'm leaving to Beijing. I have designed a new course on trade and gender. I'm a trade law academic, teaching at a Mexican university, ETEM. and I'm going to be teaching this course for the very first time at CUPL, Chinese University of Political Science and Law, and I can't be luckier to be traveling with this book. Congratulations.
So to your students, it's downloadable free of charge. It's a global public good. Go to our website, you can download it free of charge. I wanted
Thank
to
you.
Give Anabel, before I ask Judith to come in, I wanted to give Anabel, Anabel has been a trade negotiator.
I say bring the algorithm, no question. But I wanted to highlight the fact, which is something I think that it's sort of underlined the book, but it hasn't been said explicitly, which is there are many interconnections among all of these areas in the book. And I think that, you know, that I was listening with great interest to what each of the panelists were saying. And for instance, in the case of Nuria, but, you know, she's speaking to technology. The relationship between trade and technology is of the utmost importance because technology does not know frontiers. And it needs a framework to underpin you know, the interaction of technology in all of this realms that she was talking about. So, you know, being in a house like this where we are, the house of trade negotiations, we need to be mindful about the connections between trade and technology, trade and labor, human rights, trade and migration, all these different aspects that have been touched here. And you know, if we look at the book, this diversity should remind us that, you know, it's not a diversity in silos, it's a diversity in interconnection.
Excellent. You're almost stealing the thunder from Marion, but hold on a minute. Judith.
Thank you. Thank you for the wonderful interventions. I've learned a lot. I had two quick questions, one for Nuria. So as you said, many policymakers are discussing about these issues without having the expertise. And the truth is that in many developing countries, especially the poorest one, they also don't have Nurias to advise them on these issues. So how do we create inclusive governance systems to discuss these issues? And how do we do it when, at the same time, in a number of countries, these discussions may not even have started? Do we have existing governance frameworks? Do we have to invent new ones? And then the second question is for Leila. I'm an Italian Eritrean, so all of these issues you have raised really ring through also when I see it in my community. But the pushback I see on immigration is really almost making it impossible to have this type of discussions. And all of your arguments, I want to be provocative, are really falling on deaf ears, for example, in my country. So what is the kind of message? What do you think should we actually be trying to really say and to make sure that this message actually comes across also to the majority of the people who then go to the polls and vote? Thank you.
Well, thank you for the question. I think it's a difficult question. So education is key, and I am chief data scientist in a global NGO called Data Pop Alliance, and one of the, and this is just an example, there are others, but one of the key areas of activity that we do is education to policymakers and decision makers. So we have collaborated with the United Nations, and we teach in the United Nations university system to United Nations personnel. And we also collaborate with governments in developing their data AI strategies and nationally and so forth. Of course, it's difficult to scale. You know, the world is very big, and we need more initiatives like this. Luckily, technology helps. There is a lot of online material, so I don't think it's a lack of information or a lack of teaching material. Sometimes it's more the lack of, like, maybe the willingness to prioritize this and to invest in, you know, educating and learning, you know, in the public administrations and so forth as a prior step before you actually start implementing policies, you know, or making decisions. Through the years, I see a huge increase in the awareness towards this, and I see a huge increase in the movements that are happening both in developing and developed countries. So I think that's a good sign. I think there are some developing countries that are very active and maybe even ahead of some developed countries, so that's also an opportunity for the developing world. But I still, even if I see kind of like movement in the right direction, me personally, I don't think that we have the senses or the sense of urgency that I think we should have, because technological developments are very fast, technological phenomena tend to be exponential, social phenomena, legal phenomena, everything else tends to be linear, and the gap, you know, keeps getting bigger. So what I would like to encourage all of you is to, in whatever countries, you know, you are from or work with, to really try to advocate, you know, and evangelize for, you know, new governance models that take into account, you know, the digital world. And then the last point that I want to make is I don't think that as a society we feel empowered enough. I get the feeling that we feel that technology happens to us and that somehow we have this inevitable future that somehow someone is deciding, basically a handful of American or Chinese companies, and that somehow we have no say on that when it should be completely different. We should decide what we want to do with technology. We should decide how we want to use the technology, but we won't be able to decide if we don't understand what we are talking about. And I think generally as a society, we don't understand. We don't have enough critical thinking, and we don't have enough understanding with enough depth to really have that critical thinking. And that's why I always try to encourage everyone to take ownership, you know, of their own destiny, because I worry a lot. I think the massive accumulation of power in a handful of companies is beyond borders, is beyond governance. They are not directed by democratically elected presidents, and they have power over billions of people, and this, which is all of us. So I think this is something that we really need to feel that we, all of us here, not the experts, I mean, I happen to be an expert, but not the experts, you know, anyone should feel that we decide, not that someone is deciding for us.
Wow, there is a hashtag that she's just giving us. Hashtag no inevitable future. Leila.
Yeah, well, thank you for the question. I understand what you are saying, actually, because for this chapter, I went and interviewed several private sector leaders, civil society leaders, immigrant, public officials. Then I understand what you are saying, really, and I will speak a little bit about the experiences afterward. But again, like technology, actually, we can't really stop migration. And migration, they are really using technology, then they are not restrained by policies. Then when they are speaking about crowdfunding platform, for instance, this I interviewed with someone in Tunisia and in France, an immigrant in France, that basically they created the platform in France because it was not possible to do it in Tunisia because there is no law. Then here, France is mainly benefiting it. And also for investment fund, because there is no regulatory in home countries, they will create it in host countries, but they will create this anyway. And they will not, when they invest in, for instance, Efficiency Club, this is a club of African diaspora in France, they created a trust fund for to fund SMEs all over Africa. Then simply what will happen? Take Tunisia, for instance, and Morocco. Morocco now is more advancing than my country, Tunisia, in terms of attracting investment. Then simply these are investors in the end. They will go to the country where there is more advantage. Then here you have a race, actually, like trade and investment. The country that is more aware about the benefit that they can take from migration and migrant investors, the more they will have increased in benefit and the pie, and they can also address the problem of youth employment at home. Because here also, we need to understand what is at stake at home. We are speaking about countries where there is high unemployment of youth and youth graduates. Then I would say that what Nuria actually really stressed, technology here is leading a part. And even if you are putting barriers to stop things, I'm not sure that really this will happen. But in terms of pushback, I worked on this from home country perspective. But of course, I think even if you can't maybe host people permanently, I think temporary workers still benefit a lot to people at home. And this could really help improve their life, but it's not addressed in this. Now, speaking about, when we speak about public officials, in order to put this, or to think about policies,
There is a problem of, I think, old habits and thinking with rule and regulatory frameworks, and we are not evolving with our time and with technology. And I for my country, for instance, this is a really challenge, and I think for many countries. If you really don't, you are not aware that things are evolving, that the generation today are thinking differently from older generation. For instance, central bank, exchange rate, you know, regulation, they're extremely, you know, limiting people. Well, you are just not taking, you cannot seize or all the benefits. It will go to other countries that are more aware of the benefits they can have.
Gabrielle, you wanted to...
Very briefly, yes. Because you just mentioned, of course, trade, migration, exchange rate, and that's the intelligence. And congratulations to you and Marion of this book. It, as you said, it's not just about gender and trade or anything like this. It is global economic governance, which, and I support that she left, the lady ambassador of Botswana. The trade, what we call lawyers, the trade and, this is what global economic governance is all about. You need to look at everything, and you cannot do as it was initially thought. The World Health deals just with health and the IT, et cetera, specialization. It's not possible. And an answer can only come if you put them all together. And this is where I believe we can take lessons from how the WTO has dealt with difficulties against all those pushback in areas such as health and environment, for instance, and trade and labor is only one of them. But congratulations for having been able to grasp that global economic governance, of course, needs women, but is about everything and how putting all this together.
So this is a very nice segue into Marion. How do we put all of this together?
Thank you, Arancha, for giving me the floor. Of course, it feels great to be here after having put together this, this book. Very proud to have been working with so many great contributors, very proud also to be a co-editor of a book that holds the foreword of the Chancellor of what happens to be my home country, Germany, of Angela Merkel. Very pleased on a personal level to prove wrong one of the prejudices that I've been exposed to during the many years of my career, the prejudice that women cannot work together. And as a mother of two daughters, I've learned that that's a prejudice my daughters already hear in primary school. When women work together, the outcome are things like this book. And the outcomes are brilliant ideas, new proposals, new ideas for policies on how to meet the challenges this world is confronting today. I think you will find in this book many ideas on how to deal with the environmental changes, the societal changes, the technological changes that this world is facing. And I think this book, and I hope this book shows that the 28 contributors and many other women in this world stand ready to contribute to meeting that challenge and above all to build the trust that many citizens seem to have lost in our economic systems and in the policymakers that shape those systems. With this, I thank you all for contributing. I thank you for being here. And I pass the floor back to Arancha.
So we are going to end here. The authors will be signing books at the table. So if you're interested, this is the moment. A big thanks to all of you, to Leila, to Gabrielle, to Nuria, to Anabel, to Maria Teresa. Thank you very much for being with us today. Thank you, Anne. Thank you, Isa, too. Big applause to them, please. And I have to make two special thanks, if you allow me. One is to Marion, who did not throw me out of the window when I said we're going to do a great new thing in addition to the tons of work that you already had to do. Thank you, Marion, because I think you've worked like a dog to get this done, and the result is incredible. But also thanks to Evelyn, that is hiding somewhere there, who has been behind the scenes putting this book together. I think she deserves a big applause also. Thank you to the entire IT team that is behind the scenes working to deliver this great result to you. And thanks to you for joining us. Enjoy the rest of the day.